Welcome. I will talk about Clang Static Analyzer and how to implement cross-translation unit analysis and also some measurement. And this work is a cooperation between Eötvös-Loránd University and Ericsson. So first, I will show you a motivation. Why is it important to have cross-translation unit analysis? And we will overview the architecture that we implemented, and also we evaluated this work on some open source projects. So I will show you the data we get, and after I will raise some design questions that are open to debate. And finally, I will show what needs to be done. So first, let's do some quick recap what the Clang Static Analyzer capable of. So Clang Static Analyzer is basically a tool to find bugs in the code without running it. And it does symbolic execution, which is very similar to interpreting the code, but we do not have concrete inputs. So I think the best way to get familiar with this concept is to look at an example. So let's imagine we try to analyze this function here, and we have no information what the value of b can be, so the static analyzer introduces a symbol for this unknown value. And there is a switch, so there are multiple execution pads within this function. So in case the value of b is not 1 or 4, nothing interesting will happen. In case the value of b is 1, we know the exact value of b, and we can detect a division by 0, and we can halt the execution of this path. And in case we know the value of b is 4, we can calculate the concrete value of C, and we can detect the division by zero error. So, and we can report this to the user. So basically, doing this kind of path-sensitive analysis, we can find errors in the code, and when we find a very serious error, then we do not continue the analysis on that execution path. And this graph that we built is called the exploded graph. And basically the nodes of this graph are symbolic program states. And when we present this error to the user, we mark all the important decisions along this execution path. So which branch did we take? Which function did we enter? And these steps, when we take a branch and we enter a function, etc., we call these bug pass elements, and the whole length of the bug report is a bug pass length. So why it is important to have cross-translation unit analysis? Let's imagine this example where one function called neg is implemented in a separate translation unit. So if we try to analyze a.cpp without any knowledge about the implementation of the neg function, when we first call the function neg, because of the guarding condition, we know that the value pointed by x must be positive. However, after the call to neg, we have no knowledge about the value pointed by x, because the neg function could have done anything about this value. So we might take this branch, which is actually never executed. So any error that we report on an infeasible execution path is a false positive. So this way we reported a false positive, and also we did not detect an API misuse, so we passed a null pointer, which will be dereferenced later on. So we lose useful true positive results, and also introduce false positive results because of the lack of information. At Ericsson, they are using closed source tools that are capable of cross-translation unit analysis. And we found that these tools can report very useful errors. So the question is whether we can achieve the same using the Clang Static Analyzer, and spoiler alert, we can. So let's look at how the Clang Static Analyzer works from the high level right now. So there is a source code, and from some source we have the list of compilation commands, and we can use this information to analyze the code and get some outputs. And what we propose in order to achieve this cross-translation unit analysis is to have a two-pass analysis instead of a one-pass analysis. In the first pass, we analyze every translation unit and build the syntax tree, dump it to the disk, and build a function definition index. So for each function, we know in which AST dump is the AST of the implementation. And also we build a global call graph. And in the second pass, we are using this information to actually do the analysis step, when we can lazily load the bodies of the functions from these AST dumps that we created earlier. So in order to evaluate how good this approach is, we used some open source C projects, because the C++ support still needs some improvement. And there is a link that you can visit for the details for all of the numbers. And we used different metrics to get a good sense how well this kind of analysis can work. So if you go to the link, you will see a table like this. Here there are lots of open source projects that we analyzed, and you can see how many of the cross-translation units, how many of the translation units were analyzed successfully, how much time did it take with this feature enabled and with this feature disabled, the analysis, and also the memory usage. And there are some other links. For example, if I check the memory usage of a project, I can see the list of the memory usage for each of the translation units when the analyzer analyzed that translation unit. And I'm trying to go back, but I'm fortunately, well, let's go back to the URL. And also, okay. And also we did some measurement with how well the analysis covered the source code. So here you can see some coverage related information. And if you check a translation unit, you can see which lines were covered and which lines weren't covered by the analysis. So for example, this branch was never taken during the execution of the Clang Static Analyzer. So we can use this information to get some sense how good the overall quality of the analysis is. So we did see this. So let's look at the evaluation itself. So when we were running this kind of analysis on this project, we was experiencing a huge bump in the number of reports by the analyzers. And also we experienced that some of the results were lost after enabling this feature, but not too many of them. And later on I will elaborate why this phenomenon happens. So basically, at some cases, we also experienced five times as many reports by the analyzer when we turned this feature on. And as you can imagine, because we have more information available and we can analyze longer execution paths. Sometimes we found reports with longer backpass lengths. And for this reason, the median of the backpass lengths were also increased when we enabled this feature for most of the projects. But interestingly, for one of the projects we analyzed, actually the median of the backpass lengths were decreased. And when we started to evaluate the quality of these bug reports, we experienced that when we found a false positive, the reason for the false positive report was never the feature that we added, but even if we would copy the code into the same translation unit, the analyzer would have done the same decisions. This is a distribution among the new findings between the checkers. And there is only one interesting aspect, which is not very surprising, that all of the new findings are pass sensitive, because pass sensitive checks can benefit a lot from the additional information. And I would like to show one example of a cross-translation unit finding. So this code is for FFMPEG, and here we have this frame, and this frame is initialized here, and in case we are unable to find a proper decoder, we go to this label, and there we call this frame-free function. And when we entering this frame-free function, we can see we are reading an uninitialized value. So basically, this is a true positive result, which we could not find without this cross-translation unit analysis. And also, when we are loading these AST chunks from the disk, we can find one definition rule violation errors. So basically, using this kind of analysis gives us one more useful check for free. So one interesting phenomenon is that it can sometimes happen we see the same bug on multiple execution paths. For example, here we are calling the function neg with a null value from multiple places. And this can also happen within a single translation unit, but this effect is amplified when we are using cross-translation unit analysis. The question whether this is the same bug or these are two separate bugs it can be unique for each cases, because in case the function neg should handle this case, then it is one bug. In case the caller who shouldn't have passed this, that value to neg, then it is two distinct bugs. So sometimes it is a bit of a challenge to group these similar bugs together, so present this to the user in a user-friendly way. When we take a look at the analysis time, we can see that they are in line with the number of reports. So for example, a two times increase in the analysis time, we usually get around two times increase in the number of bug reports as well. So I think the scalability of the bugs per time ratio is quite good. And we also evaluated the memory usage, And we have seen very similar results to the analysis time. And as you can see, the peak memory usage was about 600 megabytes, so it's still feasible to run this analysis on a personal computer, so we do not need to buy huge servers to execute this cross-translation unit analysis. And also, during the analysis, when we are dumping these ASTs to the disk, for example, in case of LLVM, we can consume about 40 gigabytes of disk space, but this is only temporary, so we can erase this after the analysis is done. So let's go a bit more technical and look at how the implementation works. The initial implementation was done by Artem and Alexei et al., and they had a prototype which had this cross-translation unit analysis and also a summary-based interprocedural analysis, and it was based on Clang 3.4. So we took their implementation, and we only took the cross-translation unit analysis part and improved it further, and prepared a very relatively small patch, which is now up for review, and we would really appreciate the review from the community. So one of the big advantage of this approach is that we did not need to do any changes to the checkers, so we do not need to rewrite anything. It is just an upgrade to the core analysis engine. When we are invoking the static analyzer, one natural question is in which order should we analyze the functions? So the analyzer tries to give as much context for a function as possible. So when we are analyzing a.cpp, we will first analyze h, so we have a calling context available for the analysis of g, and then we will have a calling context available for the function f, and then we have a calling context available for the function I. And we will not reanalyze g, f, and I within this translation unit, because we already analyzed them with a calling context, so we will not reanalyze them with less information without a calling context. However, if we are starting to analyze b.cpp, then the new top-level function in this translation unit will be f, so we will analyze f without a calling context as a top-level function, and we will analyze I with the information from F. And also, let's look at the incrementality. So let's imagine I have run the cross-translation unit analysis and it found a null dereference in my code. So I'm trying to fix this issue. Unfortunately, I failed to put the defensive check to the right place. And now if I rerun the analysis on b.cpp, then I will find that the null dereference issue is disappeared, even though my fix is incorrect. So what happened? In order to reproduce the correct report, I also need to reanalyze a.cpp, so not just the translation unit I changed, but also other translation units. This problem only exists when we have this cross-translation unit analysis, so in order to use this kind of analysis incrementally, we need to do additional research. So let's look at what the implementation does. It basically uses the AST importer, which is a component of Clang, which can merge two pieces of AST into one. And it can import one function or type at a time, which is very good because we can do this cross-translation unit analysis lazily. We only import a function when we encounter a call to that particular function. And it also caches the results, so we will not do redundant imports during the analysis of a translation unit. It is used by LLDBs, so the static analyzer wouldn't be the only user of this code. Unfortunately, this is not a mature component of Clang yet. So one of the problems we encountered is that when we are importing source locations that are the result of macro expansions, sometimes we have issues. So when we are reporting to those locations an error to the user, then the analyzer can crash. And also, the AST importer has suboptimal results for C++ projects. This is the reason why we did our initial evaluation on C projects. And also it had some C related bugs that we are fixing right now. And the analysis can also find AST importer related bugs because the AST of Clang have lots of invariants that are not trivial to check. And when we are running the static analyzer on the imported AST, sometimes we hit asserts that are trying to validate these invariants. So triggering these asserts can discover hidden bugs in the AST importer. So having this feature upstream can help us to write more rigorous testing for the AST importer. And we also found some issues using this approach that are otherwise very hard to write a test for. Sometimes we found that we to have a proper test for a fix, we should write a lot of complicated code just to have a test case that fails before the fix. So let's talk a bit about the coverage. So why was it important to measure the coverage of the analysis? And what results did we have? So the coverage increased for some files, which is not surprising because some function calls are evaluated in more contexts. And for some other files, it decreased when we turned the cross-translation unit analysis on. So this could be because we have an analysis budget. So of course, having a path-sensitive analysis can explode in the branching factor. So in order to have analysis time that is that we can wait. So we have a lot of budgets. So how many nodes can we build during the analysis? How many function calls or how many basic blocks can we visit? How much times can we visit the same basic block? So using this kind of budget gives us a good way to control the execution time, and we can run out of this budget more easily when we have more functions available to evaluate. And also, because we have more information available, we can prune more infeasible paths. So actually sometimes losing coverage is intended and good for the analysis. And also, we can report more issues. And when we report a serious issue, like a division by zero, then we cannot represent a valid program state after this error happened. So on that execution pass, we stop the analysis. So this is also an intended way to lose coverage. And we found that the overall sum of these effects is that we found there is a small decrease in the coverage of these open source projects. So it looks like something is wrong with my slides, but this is a piece of the exploded graph, and sometimes the other parts are hidden. So if we would like to find this division by zero and we do not have cross-translation unit analysis, we can find it with a very low budget because we can evaluate the call to the external function conservatively, and in the next step we can find the division by zero error. Oh, it looks like only the Okay, it looks like only the order of the animation was wrong. So basically, in this exploded graph, first we evaluate the function call, and then we can find the division by zero. However, if we have the function body of this external available, then the analysis, because it's using a DFS, so the analysis budget can be exhausted while we are analyzing this external function. And because of the budget is exhausted, we never get to the point where we evaluate the division by zero. So this way, we can lose true positive results. So in case you are interested in this kind of analysis, what should you do? So I think it is definitely good to try it out and check if it can find you interesting new reports. But if you are scared of losing some of the coverage, one option might be to run the analyzer both with this feature enabled and disabled. So in case you have enough computing power to do that, then probably this is one of the best way to go. This way you can get the best from all of these options. And we would really appreciate any feedback you can give us about the quality of the reports after this feature is turned on. And also, code checker is a good way to view these CTU results because it is already supporting to show you bug paths that is going across multiple translation units. So in the future, we plan to improve the C++ support of the AST importer. And also it might be useful to come up with new strategies to build an exploded graph that have a better shape and not building it with this DFS like strategy. And also maybe it would make sense to use a distinct default values for the budget when we are turning this cross-translation unit support on. And it would be great to come up with a way how to do this incrementally at the user's machine. And also there are some low-hanging fruits how to make the AST dumps smaller. It is not a feature in the Clang Static Analyzer, but a feature in the viewers. So it would be useful to group together those bug reports that might be the result of the same error, like when we find the same bug on multiple execution pads. So to summarize this talk, we improved the CTU prototype, and the improved version is now up for review. And we evaluated how well it performs on open source project. And we showed that it can find very useful bugs, very, very useful reports that are actually true positive findings. And the analysis time scales very well with the number of CPUs. And the bug per time and bug per memory ratio is satisfying. And also we are satisfied with the overall coverage on this project. It works really well for C programs, at least the C programs we tested. And there are some improvements need to be done to be useful on C++ project. So thank you for your attention, and I hope I can answer all your questions.
I have a function returning some pointer, and I 90% of the call sites, I check if the pointer return is a single pointer, and I forgot to monitor it. Right? And like, if I would like to do some kind of this statistical analysis, is it possible?
Okay, so the way the Clang Static Analyzer works does not support this kind of analysis. However, similar statistical analysis when we are checking how often do we check the return value of a function makes a lot of sense when we are doing it in a cross-translational unit way. I think it can be implemented relatively easily with this two-pass analysis framework, but this kind of checks would use a separate way of working than what the Clang static analyzer does. So it wouldn't be a pass-sensitive check like the one that I showed earlier with that test function, but something that is using a completely different part of the analyzer.
Thank you. So we've been already using the project, CTU, in our project, and so far it has been interesting. Thank you for great work. One of the things that we run into is the visualization. So for the regular static analysis, you can just generate the static site, the static HTML pages. And we see that as a great feature because it allows us to integrate the regular static analysis into the CI pipeline. And for each build, generate a site, upload it somewhere, and DevOps can go and just grab it. For the cross-translation version, you need to use the application. So we've been using the one built by Ericsson, the code viewer, which is run as a full-blown and quite heavy application in our opinion. So I was wondering, do you have any plans to extend the normal generator, the one we're talking about, static analyzer, to support cross-translation analysis, so we can use this?
Okay, so the source of the problem that you experienced was that, so right now, or at least some weeks ago, the Clang Static Analyzer did not have support to generate HTML reports that had an execution pass that goes across multiple files. So sometimes, even in a single translation unit, when the execution pass crossed the file boundary, HTML report wasn't generated. And I'm remembering there is a patch at the fabricator to solve this problem. I'm not sure whether it is accepted yet or not. So in case you are interested in generating static HTMLs after this patch is landed, it should work out of the box. And regarding code checker, we did not consider this kind of workflow yet when you need to get a static HTML page as the end result, but I think it's a very interesting feature request that we will consider to implement.
What is the license of your code?
Okay, so we are, so which part of, if you mean this patch is up for review at the fabricator, so you are free to apply this patch and basically we would like to contribute it back to the project so it has the same LLVM license. And in case you are also interested in measuring the coverage, that code is not upstreamed yet, but it is available on GitHub, and we also did not specify any separate license for that, so it also have LLVM license.
I have two comments about that. Some people work in organizations that have paranoid lawyers, so you should really specify a license. Okay, even if you just say it's available under the LLVM license, that would make some people's lawyers happy because they have no license and they think, oh, okay, we can't use it ever.
We will look into that. Thank you.
But the other question is you talked a little bit about C++ analysis, and the impression I got from your talk was that the big hang-up is in the AST import. The bugs in the AST importers are not necessarily a lot of work that you need to do in the cross-translation unit analysis phases. Mm-hmm. And you just need to get better data in.
Yes, correct? Yes. So basically after the AST importer has a proper C++ support, this architecture will just work. So that is the only place that we need to improve to be able to use this on C++ project.
Well, I'm looking forward to that because I have a significant body of complicated C++ code that I love to analyze.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Great talk, thank you very much. And my question is, you mentioned that one of the problems is that you have some fixed budget, and by going through some kind of EFS, you lose coverage. Have you considered using something more fancy than just an EFS, some more,
yes.
A better strategy for your
business? Mm-hmm. Okay, so So the reason, one of the reasons why DFS is used is because when we are done with the analysis of an execution path, then we will not continue the analysis on that path, we can basically reclaim the memory that was used for the analysis. And when we are doing like a BFS and we are exploring more execution paths simultaneously, we need to keep these exploded graph nodes in the memory for more time. So basically, why we are using this, because it is more memory efficient, and we will look into alternative strategies that gives us a better trade-off between the shape and the memory usage of this graph.
So thank you again for the great talk. For this example in particular, do you mean that supposing that this path is truncated because it's too long, the on execution does not even proceed to x divided by 0 at all, or do you proceed to that statement with less information than if you had expanded the path?
Okay, so in some cases the analyzer does that. So in some cases the analyzer will, for example, for when we are analyzing loops and when we turn on a specific feature of the analyzer and the analyzer gives up the analysis of a particular loop, it continues the analysis after the loop, but with less information, of course. So we could do something similar here. But right now it is not implemented. But it is definitely an interesting idea. Thank you.
Right. Here we have another one.
Okay.
Do you have any plans for supporting stubbing or implementations of certain common functions, for example, allocators, so that the analysis doesn't go into them because there's typically nothing to be found there?
Mm-hmm. So right now there is some stubbing done in the analyzer. There is a component, I do not recall the name, but basically body form. Okay, so there is a component called body form, and also there are some checkers that have the sole purpose of modeling some very frequently used library APIs like the C standard library. So even when there is no cross-translation unit analysis available, the analyzer have a really good understanding of some frequently used functions. So this can be done. And I think but there is no So right now there is no easy way to do this for your own without implementing a new check in the static analyzer. So it would be really good to have a way for that. And also I think we should discuss it a bit later, because there is a way that almost works to do this kind of stubbing.
Okay, time for one or two more.
Hey, thanks for the talk. I was just wondering whether you've given any thought to, well, now that you have this architecture that you're actually aiming to work across translation units, whether you've thought about summarizing some functions. So maybe you don't want to analyze, say, a simple function that doesn't support anything else, rather than constantly inline, like keep always inlining it, or just analyze it once and say this function might have a non-pointed reference, but I don't have enough information.
Right. So Artem, Alexei et al., they also implemented a summary-based interprocedural analysis, and it is very good to have a summary-based analysis because it can improve the performance a lot. But unfortunately, with this summary-based analysis they introduced, the checkers need to be rewritten. It's not always a big change, but this is something that the community wasn't very happy with. I know that they are using this summary-based approach internally at Samsung, I believe. But the communities of static analyzer is interested in having this summary-based approach, but it would be great to have it in a way that all of the checkers that were written already would work out of the box without any modification with this approach.
One more, we have time. Okay, no questions anymore. So let's thank the speaker.
Thank you.